you so much, Dan. Thank you so much for having me here, and it's great following Glenn. There you go. Glenn, who was, when I was teaching a class called Writing Short Fiction from Life Experience, was our class's favorite guest speaker. And I think we heard a little snippet of his memoir, which I snipped out of the East Bay Express many, many years ago. So it's great to follow you. Back when we were reading in December, I had chosen this piece. It's from a novel in progress, and it was December 12th, I think, so it was the week of Pearl Harbor, and this happened to have something sweet in it, and was also, this particular beginning of the book is based, it's set on December 8th, 1941. And the novel is about the Japanese-American community in New York City during World War II, who were not interned. And I know that Brian, who's going to be reading after the break, has a book of poetry about internment camps, and this is about the people who were not interned during the war. So it's 4 a.m., December 8th, 1941. 10 minutes after four, Masako blinked into the darkness that was not quite black. The flicker of street lamps leaked thin, jittery lights, lines of light around the window shade, a high whining noise, sirens, a clattering of cars down Amsterdam Avenue. The door to her bedroom swung open, and there was her boy, Nobu, curled against the frame. He clawed at his belly, and his legs churned. The sound of his cry scissored through the darkness, waking her husband. His angry cough punched into the pillow beside her. Itai, mama, itai! Where? Doko, where does it hurt? But it was clear where. His palm dug into the soft spot between his ribs. She pulled the sheet aside and let him crawl into bed, his teeth chattering. His hair smelled tangy like sweat and fear. She felt his cheek. Atsuine, he's burning, he's so hot. Masako nudged her husband's foot with hers. Koromo sick, call doc. Her voice held a pleading note. He turned and grunted toward the clock. Middle of night, you wait till light time. The closest phone was in Onuma-san's apartment, three flights up. They didn't have one of their own. She dreaded the thought of climbing the stairs in her flannel nightclothes and knocking on her neighbor's door. Pressing his body against her, she practiced silently, bowing her head even into the pillow. Gomenasai, Onuma-san, gomenasai, I'm sorry, it's so late, sorry to wake you. I know, but we need to call Doc, it's an emergency, hi, it's important. Her husband barked at her, no, he's not a baby, no calling in the middle of the night. What do you want to do, wake them up all for nothing? He shifted angrily in the tangled sheets. Baka boy, stupid, he just ate too much sweet stuff at the church party, those donuts. He jabbed her with his elbow. Put your finger in his throat, make him throw up, that's all he needs. Nobu-chan, your papa's going to call Doc, she lied to her boy. Everything will be all right, daijoubu, don't worry. She murmured into his hair, but was anything going to be all right ever again? As her head cleared from the merciful fog of sleep, the nightmare of the previous day sharpened. Her heart began rattling as she remembered the young boy shouting to the whole church the news they'd heard on the radio. Pearl Harbor, Nihon, a bomb, and the beginning of war. All the confusion, people not knowing whether to run home or huddle together, whether to cry for themselves as Americans or as daughters and sons and grandchildren of those who lived in those narrow islands halfway around the earth. The children, Nobu included, had been so confused at the sight of adults groaning and weeping, and even the minister wiping his eyes and looking suddenly weary. Thank goodness for Eiko, the Sunday school teacher, emptying sacks of sugar donuts onto platters for a spontaneous snack. How quickly her mind had worked, thinking to make it into a game. Her sparrow voice calling out in a gay, trembly way, Kodomo, over here, everyone for donut contest, special prize. The adults were startled out of their shock and grateful to Eiko, they rounded the children up by height. Michael, the tallest boy in the youth group, helped tie the string across the fellowship room like a laundry line, and then twined the donuts hanging down at 12-inch intervals. Nobu was one of the shortest ones. He'd stood on a stool at the far end, his round mouth open and ready. Eiko giggled at the children, so cute, and then her shrill voice, hi, begin. Michael Yuzawa took a quick bite, but his fell on the floor, the first one out. One little rascal tried to use her fingers and got called out for cheating. Only her Nobu-chan, like a clever Nezumi, little mouse, kept up his quick nibbles all around until the ring of cake grew thinner and thinner, the white sugar ringing his lips. Finally, an empty string, nothing on the floor, and his victorious grin. Eiko fished the final prize from her pocketbook, something she was lucky to find, a 25-cent ticket for the Ghost of Frankenstein playing down on 37th Street. She handed it over to Nobu, and it was as grand as a silver trophy. How proudly he buttoned it into his pocket and propped it on top of the bureau in his room. Josune, she praised him, good boy. After the happy distraction of the donut game, the adults fell into somber circles. She heard them murmuring about the FBI, how those sons of bitches were already, how there was going to be trouble. And already the trouble came to them as they stood near the church door to go home, a group of them hesitating and looking out on 57th Street as if their concrete steps were an island in the middle of an enormous sea. Nobody wanted to step out onto the sidewalk and venture out there. It looked exactly as it had when they'd entered church at 10 in the morning, but somehow everything had changed. There was no question that there would be trouble, and it showed up as if they'd called out to it. A black Oldsmobile screaming on rubber tires sped crookedly down the street, veering towards and away from the curb. Masako could not forget the face of the driver through the windshield, both of his hands strangling the wheel, his teeth showing as if he wanted to chew the flesh from their bones. The others in the car, a tangle of blurred and flailing arms, their faces twisted with hatred. The windows were open and the car hurtled toward them like an insect with multiple limbs. Goddamn Japs, you'll get yours. Their voices bellowed from the car. Japs, Japs, the violent sound of their shouting first, and then the barrage of eggs, yellow yolk bombs exploding all around them. Mochizuki-san, frail and nearly blind, had stumbled backwards in fear and then stood gasping as a puddle of urine spread around her shoes. Her shame nearly made her faint. Then they came for the minister. They took him away as he stood at the vestibule of the church, shaking hands in farewell. She'd heard the clattering of heels on the steps. They're taking sensei. Bits of sticky rice clinging to her wrist, she rushed upstairs with the rest of them to see their minister still in his robes, billowing full of frigid winter air, his head bent, his hands encircled in bright metal. Their minister, in handcuffs, bowed his head and folded himself neatly into the car before they had the chance to lay their hands on the black flapping wing of his robes.